On this edition of Wealth Track, great value investor Joel Greenblatt on some revolutionary ideas from his new book, Common Sense, The Investor's Guide to Equality, Opportunity, and Growth.
Big picture, I'm a capitalist, obviously, but capitalism only works if everyone has a fair chance. And there are so many places where they don't. If you're thinking of places to give back or to help change things, the book is really about what can we do, either from the within the private sector or the public sector, to change things that pretty much everyone wants to change.
That's this week on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
Funding provided by Morgan Le Fay Dreams Foundation, Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Miller Value Funds, Royce & Associates, Matthews Asia, First Eagle Investment Management, and Strategus Asset Management.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. One of the biggest issues to emerge from the pandemic is income inequality. It has become even more pronounced as millions of low-income workers lose their jobs and the much smaller number of high-income workers keep theirs and benefit from a powerful bull market. This week's guest is on a crusade to change this dynamic by giving opportunities to lower-income individuals and their families to achieve economic success. He is great value investor and financial thought leader Joel Greenblatt. He has a new book, Common Sense, The Investor's Guide to Equality, Opportunity, and Growth. And like Thomas Paine, who successfully campaigned against the monarchical and tyrannical rule of Great Britain over the 13 colonies in 1776 with his widely read pamphlet, Common Sense, Greenblatt is on a crusade to disrupt the established order in a few key areas, including education, corporate hiring, taxation, and immigration. One area ripe for disruption is the education system, which he says is, quote, unfair, unequal, and doesn't make sense for those most in need. Case in point, over 90% of poor, low-income, and minority students don't get a college degree, yet workers with bachelor's degrees earn 73% more than high school graduates, and they in turn earn 30% more than high school dropouts. Now, Greenblatt has tackled these inequities personally by co-founding and financing the top-performing Success Academy Charter Network in New York. And he has other real-world solutions to address these gaps. Greenblatt's investment bona fides are also impressive. He is managing principal and co-chief investment officer of Gotham Asset Management, which he founded in 2009 and where he co-manages hedge funds and several hedge fund-like mutual funds, most utilizing long-short strategies. His early claim to investment fame was at his predecessor firm, Gotham Capital, where he co-managed an extremely concentrated hedge fund with 34% annualized returns over 10 years before he closed it to outside investors because he realized its volatility was too difficult for even sophisticated investors to handle. His behavioral insight that the best investment strategy is one that both makes sense and that you can stick with led to the creation of the Gotham Index Plus Fund in 2015. Index Plus combines index investing tied to the S&P 500 with actively managed long-short strategies. Normally, investment strategy would be the focus of our entire conversation. But in today's pandemic pivot, we are starting with an essential prerequisite for a successful capitalist democracy, economic opportunity for all. So I asked Greenblatt why he, a professional money manager, wrote his version of Common Sense.
Big picture, I'm a capitalist, obviously. But capitalism only works if everyone has a fair chance. And there are so many places where they don't. You know, if you're thinking of places to give back or to help change things, the book is really about what can we do, either from the within the private sector or the public sector, to change things that pretty much everyone wants to change.
So Thomas Paine, let's go back. 1776, Thomas Paine writes this pamphlet. It was a bestseller. It was incendiary. And it was kind of a common sense approach, asking a lot of questions that no one really had asked publicly in such a public way before. And, you know, railing against the tyranny of monarchy and aristocracy. pro-democracy, pro-American independence. What are you railing against?
He really didn't rail so much against taxes or, oppression. What he really looked at things as if he were just off the boat from Mars, and not really even looking at 40,000 feet, really from Mars, saying, let's start from the beginning. Who's this king guy anyway? Meaning, who picked him? did someone hundreds of years ago pick him and now we're stuck with him? Or was there an election, or did someone appoint him? And so it really starts from the beginning. And so if you really start to look at problems from the beginning, some things just don't make sense. So if you look at education in our country, the poorest kids are systematically kept from the best schools. Schools are a local affair. You go to the local school that's nearest to you.
Right.
And if that school's not good, parents with means can move, or they send their kids to private school. If you are poor or don't have means, you're stuck. And so pretty much everyone, other than those who are poor or without means, have a choice, whereas and poor and kids without means don't, and everyone else does. So it's unfair from the beginning. And so what ends up happening is those who need it the most get the worst schools.
Right. One of the things that I have said in my introduction to you is that you were a co-founder in 2006 of the Success Academy Charter Schools, which have been incredibly successful in taking kids from the exact same poor neighborhoods, minority kids, low-income kids, and they've turned out to be, more successful than most public schools throughout all of New York State, including those from very wealthy communities. You're trying to do more with your book, Common Sense, and taking on the educational establishment. So what's the alternative? What are you recommending?
Well, first, we have to start with the premise. The best charter schools and the best district schools really prove a key point. At Success, kids with disabilities outperform kids without disabilities in the district schools. Kids who are English language learners outperform, and that used to be called English as a second language, those kids mm-hmm. outperform kids in the district schools where English is their first language. If you just take a look at the homeless kids, and there's 20,000 kids at Success and 45 schools, and if you just look at the homeless kids as a group, they outperform Scarsdale and every one of the wealthiest school districts in New York. Poor and low-income kids, if you take those as a group, which is well over 80% of the kids at the school, they outperform gifted and talented schools where you have to test to get into the schools. Black, brown, and white kids all do the same. So the idea is that with the right supports, kids can really accomplish. Kids of all background can perform at super high levels. And the question is, what can you do with that?
And I'll just say that I've just come in from Mars, and I'm seeing these success stories, and I'm wondering, why have you gotten such, pushback? Why aren't these models being adopted, and adapted throughout the state, throughout the country? What's your solution to this?
All right. Well, how do you beat, we spend actually about $700 billion a year, K-12 education, and over $1 trillion a year if you include college. And so very hard to disrupt, a big organization and big spending like that. What I read about in the book, is something I talk about my kids at Columbia, my students at Columbia, I asked a question every semester. I say, how do you beat Tiger Woods? Mm-hmm. And the answer is don't play him in golf. And so the question is, how can we do a roundabout about the system? How can we get around the system to give these kids who clearly have the ability with the right supports to perform at super high levels? And that's pretty much everyone.
And so what's the roundabout?
Yeah, the roundabout is alternative certification, which means the idea is that top companies, the Microsofts, Google, JP Morgan, Facebook, the idea is for them to set standards. And the standards would be not a college degree, typically, because if you really look, the chances of an inner city kid graduating college is 1 out of 11.
Right.
So if you're poor and in an urban center, anywhere in the country, your odds on average are about 1 in 11 of graduating college. So the idea is for these leading companies to set standards, to say basically, look, college degree is fine, but if you don't have a college degree, if you can take these courses and do okay, either pass or do well, and pass these tests that we stated. I'm not saying these companies should give the tests. I'm saying they should say which tests, if you pass, and which courses, if you take, if you do that, doesn't have to be college courses, could be courses from anywhere. If you do well on these, we'll consider you for a high paying job. And we'll tell you which courses and tests that we will consider. And then what I'm expecting is a whole ecosystem to develop. We don't need government support for this. What I would hope is once the prize is set, and there's plenty of precedent for this, once the prize of a high paying job is on the table, then there'll be courses that spring up, there'll be online resources that spring up, there'll be tutors that spring up. They can all be rated by, just like you rate Uber drivers and Airbnb. And so they're group rated so that you know who are the good ones and who is getting results for helping kids pass these. You know, communities can get together to support these. And it doesn't really matter. It could be creative ability. It could be good at game playing. It could be a million different things that they say correlate well with good employees. So If there's demand, and the demand is a buyer, and the buyer are these leading companies that will hire these people that pass these. And I describe in the book how it can all happen. And right. You know, I go through all the arguments against why it might not work. But the wonderful thing about it is we don't need any government accreditation for any of the courses. We don't need government to set standards. This disruption can all take place. And all we have to do is have a buyer, some of the leading companies set standards. Other companies can follow them about what produces a good employee, and sort of short circuit the whole K through college system.
The tax system, you think that there's something that can be done immediately to the earned income tax credit? What is it?
Sure. Well, number one, earned income tax credit is a terrible name. I suggested just changing it to doing the right thing. and, you know, I point out the that in 2018, you know, we spent $68 billion. It's the third biggest social welfare program that we have in the country. So we do have it. And I show studies saying that the net cost of that $68 billion is really closer to $9 billion because of the jobs that people get, the taxes they pay, the children taken out of poverty. So it's huge. And all I do is suggest we expand it a little bit. You know, it was $68 billion in 2018. So I suggested we should spend about $1 trillion. That's what it would cost to get everyone to over $15. And what is an earned income tax credit? It just says, listen, if your skill set is contributes about $9 to an employer, to require him to pay you $15 is problematic if you're an economist. But if the government made up that $6 difference or $7 or whatever it might be, that's okay. And everyone would still come out all right. It would cost about $1 trillion, and I go around explaining how we'd make money from that. We talk about the value of taking kids out of childhood poverty, and I show studies showing that that costs us $1 trillion a year. So I don't think this would solve childhood poverty, but I think it would take care of about half of it. And So that would be about $500 billion. And then adult medical costs save about $200 billion. So actually, we could do it for less than free. And then I back down and say, well, you know, being realistic, we're not going to take that $68 billion up 15 times to $1 trillion, but we can triple it to $200 billion, and I show all the good that can do. So it's just crazy that we're not doing it.
Yeah. Immigration is another issue that you feel very strongly about, to create growth and opportunity. So how would you change the immigration system?
Well, the Business Roundtable did a study and showed that the United States was second to last among developed countries in encouraging skilled immigration. And it's really
hard. And explain
hard.
What skilled immigration is. It's
yeah, it's
you, know, you got to have skills to come in to be like first
right.
in line.
I mean, one way
right?
to you know, there's studies showing you know that if we took in an immigrant who had a graduate degree, the amount of taxes they pay and their children pay versus how much government benefits they get, each one we make $1 million. If you have a college BS, we make $500,000. So it's kind of a free gold mine. We specifically discourage skilled immigration in what we do. We're second to last among developed countries. The only country we beat was Japan, and they discourage immigration.
Period.
You have to speak Japanese. It's pretty pathetic that we come into second to last. I mean, it would really be tough to lose to Japan. And we already have a great program where the H-1B program, which is actually it's a terrible program, but anyone who gets through the gauntlet of making through the program, what's good about the program is employers decide who has the skills they want. So it's a one-to-one perfect match. So if someone wants to employ you, you can employ them. You have to pay a 20% tax for 5 years on that employee, but there's nothing else. Meaning, if you pay them at least $60,000 or $70,000 and you're willing to pay the government a 20% tax, which can be used for helping, you know, employees who are already here or whatever you want, you can employ them. I said, well, what about the Statue of Liberty? You know, give me your tired, your poor, unskilled immigrants and people, refugees and people seeking, you know, better life here. I'm all for that as well. You know, there's a lot of costs to taking them in. There's also a lot of cost to helping people who are already here that are in poverty. And all I'm saying is, let's take the $1 million per you know, skilled immigrant, or $500,000 per skilled immigrant. By the way, each skilled immigrant creates almost two jobs, jobs for you know, Americans who are already here. So it's crazy. You make $1 million, they create two additional jobs, and I suggest we're nuts. It's like saying, hey, there's a gold mine over there and we shouldn't do it. And there's really no reason why. I think it would be great for this country.
Makes sense, Joel. That doesn't mean that it's going to be a winning idea. No.
I'll shut up now.
Okay. Retirement plans need to change. Social Security doesn't work for the bottom half of earners. That's what you're saying in your book. What needs to change?
Yeah, so if you're a low earner, your Social Security could be $9,000. If you make in the $20,000 area, you know, in the mid-20s, you maybe make $9,000 a year from Social Security. No one has savings in the, you know, in the bottom half of income. No one has any other savings. I mean, the top 10% have plenty of savings and no one else. It's striking and terrible. And if you understand compound interest, you understand that the key to compound interest is to start early.
Right.
You know, young people don't have a lot of money to spare. Poor people don't. So very hard to get started early. So, you know, if I said blow up Social Security, that probably wouldn't be a good idea.
That's not going to happen. No.
Do I have another suggestion? Okay. Because people love their Social Security. And I understand that it's the third rail to touch it. So forget that. But what if we supplement Social Security? You know, right now, the idea behind Social Security is there's a relationship between what you put in, what you get out. So it caps out at $137,000 right now. People don't get taxed above that. And the reason for that is because we don't pay them anymore. And so one suggestion is that we continue to tax people above $137,000, their Social Security taxes. And they get to keep those. It's a little different. It's not really a tax. It goes into their own private savings account. But maybe you take 15 or 20% of that amount and you give it to young people and people who need those savings so that they can start saving at an early age. And so really we're taking, you know, little Robin Hood, taking from the wealthier people, giving it to people who need it more and younger people so that they can start compounding at an early age. And so that would be one way to do it. But the tax savings for those who are paying, you know, who are saving, you know, paying into their above 137 get to keep most, and it'll be, you know, tax advantage, so it really won't cost them very much, if any. You know, once you understand compound interest, it's like fire. And we're as a nation, we're blowing it. We're completely blowing it. We need to put compound interest to work for those who need it the most.
Right. What's the proposal that you have that you think has the greatest chance of being put into operation and can, you know, immediately get off the ground?
Yeah, I think we need to disrupt our K through college education system. So alternative certification is something that doesn't need government funding, doesn't need government accreditation, doesn't need anything. It needs leading companies to set standards. That's it for specific high-paying jobs.
In investment question for you, I'm looking at the S&P 500 and like 22% of the S&P 500 market cap is in five stocks. What's your take on that concentration in the S&P 500?
Well, you know, those businesses that make up that 22% are some of the best businesses that have ever existed in the history of the world. The network effects, are unbelievable. Their franchises are unbelievable. So what I would say is there are not hundreds of companies that rhyme with those. There are hundreds of companies that are priced as if they will be the next Amazon or Google or Microsoft. Mm-hmm. There will not be hundreds of companies that become the next, but they're priced that way.
Right.
So I would say, a lot of the market's expensive, but I don't even think it's those five stocks. I think it's the hundreds of stocks, you know, among the Russell 1000 that are priced as if they'll become those next stocks. And there will only be a handful of companies that can possibly be some of the best businesses of all time. So I don't think the overvaluation is really in those stocks. I think it's elsewhere in the market. But I can say that those five companies is not where my worries are. It's really in the hundreds of companies that people are pricing as if they will become those five companies.
Are you long or going short the Facebooks and the Amazons and the Microsofts and...
Oh, we're long those companies. They're
you're
big cash
companies.
Flow generating companies with huge returns on capital, great growth rates, great prospects. We're very long those, where we might even be overweight in a few of them.
In this pandemic market, we're seeing a really very strong bull market where the economy is really having some serious problems, and certainly among the populations that we've been talking about that you're most concerned about giving opportunity. Does that gap kind of concern you of what the market's doing and what the economy's doing?
Well, the market's really looking ahead. You know, the pandemic is an acute issue. You know, obviously,
right.
I don't want to belittle it, but it will end. And it'll end sometime in the next year or so. Most of the value of businesses comes from what they're going to earn, a couple of years out and the growth rate from there.
Right.
So these are like one-time events, but the greatness, I guess, of the ability for the government to step in and fill the hole, even if you borrowed $10 trillion, if you can borrow it for free, after mm-hmm. inflation, we can borrow for free for 30 years. It's just a quirk of what's going on right now. So I think we can handle this because it'll end. And there obviously is disruption and employment, and the government, though, can make up for that, and I think they should. So, I know there's so many terrible things that are happening as a result of it, but at least from a money standpoint, we can afford to get through this. And
right.
And
one investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, Joel, what would you have us all own some of?
Yeah, there's a Vanguard Value ETF, VTV is the symbol. And, value has taken it on the chin over the last pile of years. And, it's very interesting. I was looking back at the returns from Gotham Capital when I was running it. And in 1998, we're value investors. We were down 5%. Market was up 28.6%. In 99, we were down 5% again. That was our first 2 years. I started in 85, so first 2 years we lost money. 99, we were down 5%. Market was up over 20%. But in 2000, market was down 9%. We were up 114%. It's not that we were idiots in 98 and 99 and all of a sudden became geniuses in 2000. It's just we finally got paid for all the hard work we were doing. So I think certain of the companies that are strong cash flow generating companies that earn high returns on capital, are out of favor right now. because they're not, you know, the flavor of the day, and some of those will come back. So I think they'll be a good opportunity there in some of those value stocks. And Vanguard has good ETFs that are tax efficient to take advantage of that.
Thanks, Joel. Thank you so much. And congratulations on Common Sense.
Consuelo, thank you for much for giving me the opportunity to talk about it.
At the conclusion of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is read Common Sense, The Investor's Guide to Equality, Opportunity, and Growth by this week's guest, Joel Greenblatt. As just discussed, Greenblatt identifies key areas that are at the root of the inequality problem and has workable solutions to change them. He shows us that the U.S. can truly offer economic opportunity to everyone, regardless of where you come from. As legendary investor Howard Marks said, he recommends this book to anyone who cares about these things. It's not just for investors. In this week's extra feature on WealthTrack.com, we asked Greenblatt for his views on permanent pandemic changes. Meanwhile, please continue to connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, and our YouTube channel. Have a super weekend and make the week ahead a healthy, profitable, and a productive one.